Julius Caesar died in 44 BC, 2025 years, 1 month and 3 days before the first space shuttle took off from Launch Pad 39A in Cape Canaveral. But despite more than 2 millennia separating these events, the Romans actually played a huge role in designing the space shuttle, and it all had to do with the horse's ass. Different countries have different trains. China has the CR-400AF, Germany has the FS-1000, and America has the Acela, by far the worst of the three. It's basically the Kevin Jonas of trains. But you might be asking yourself, gee, I've never seen a train before. What are they? Are they basically cars? Well, dear viewer, you're right. A train is basically a car, just on tracks. And those tracks are what we'll be focusing on. Tracks across the world come in different gauges. That's the distance between the inner sides of the tracks. Narrower gauges are cheaper, but wider gauges allow for bigger and faster trains. Most developed countries use the standard gauge of 4 feet 8.5 inches, or 1.4 meters. But former Soviet Union countries use a slightly wider gauge at 4 feet 11 and 27 32nds of an inch, or 1.5 meters for the people who don't want to remember 27 32nds of an inch. Most of the world uses one of these two gauges, but there are some exceptions. Most of South Africa uses the much smaller 3 foot 6 inch gauge, and even Spain uses its own rail gauge at 5 foot 5 and 21 32nds of an inch, widely believed to be used to prevent a possible French invasion from using the rail system. But like we always do on this channel, let's focus on the Americans. Their tracks are 4 feet 8.5 inches, and we're gonna see this ends up being a pretty special number. Why'd they use this gauge? Well, in the 1800s, while Americans were busy invading Mexico and manifest destinying across the continent, they were also building railroads. In just 6 years, 20,000 men built a railroad 1,900 miles, or 3,000 kilometers, from Omaha, Nebraska to Sacramento, California, shrinking cross-country travel from 10 months by wagon to just 1 week by rail. But when Americans rushed to build the railroads, the people with all the experience were the British. So they used their expertise and equipment, and the American rails ended up being the same gauge as the British ones. But why were British tracks 4 feet 8.5 inches to start? Well, that's because the first English railways were built by the same men who built pre-railroad tramways. Again, the people who built the English rails used the same equipment as the people who built the earlier trams, meaning they had the same length, 4 feet 8.5 inches. Those trams were built so they'd fit in the ruts of the very old, long-distance roads that connected smaller English cities. The wheel ruts in those roads, yep, 4 feet 8.5 inches wide. And I think you know where we're going with this. 2,000 years earlier, the first roads were built by and for the Roman Empire. Now, the Romans obviously didn't build roads with grooves in them. They traveled by horse-drawn chariot. All the chariots were made to the same specification, and the weight under the wheels were carved those divots in the roads. And the final piece of the puzzle? Why were the chariot wheels spaced 4 feet 8.5 inches? The chariots were designed to be drawn by two horses. The width of the chariot's wheels needed to accommodate the widest part of the horses, their rear ends. Back then, a horse's rear was about 2 feet, so add a little margin for the Nicki Minaj horses out there, and that gave us 4 feet 8.5 inches. But how does all this give us the space shuttle? Those fly in the air, not on any ancient Roman roads. The space shuttle was made of 2.5 million parts, made by hundreds of companies across the country. And one of the most critical parts were the solid-state rocket boosters. Those two things sticking off the sides, 13 stories tall. And these gigantic boosters were built in Utah. But if the rockets got launched in Florida, why build them more than 2,000 miles away? Well, originally, NASA looked at making the boosters in Florida with the Aerojet 260 booster. They wanted to cast the aluminum exterior in Florida because the 22-foot diameter and massive weight meant it couldn't be transported very far. But when they tested the rocket, there were instant problems. The outer casing couldn't handle the stress of the test fire, and the motor itself basically disintegrated. These problems were traced back to the variable temperature and humidity during the casting. Basically, Florida's weather was so inconsistent that different parts of the boosters that were cast at slightly different times had different structures. But luckily, the Air Force had contractors that had decades of experience building rockets for them. And the only real difference between the Air Force's rockets and NASA's would be whether there was a big boom at the end. Like everything in life, there was good news and bad news. The good news is the contractor, Morton Thiokol, was based in Utah. And Utah has a very cool, dry climate with low humidity. This helped them be very consistent when casting, especially when casting multiple different segments for the rocket. But the bad news? Well, the rockets were ridiculously heavy. They would be too big for road transport, and at 1.3 million pounds, or 600,000 kilograms, were more than triple the maximum lift capacity of the largest aircraft in the world. This isn't a new problem for NASA. In the 60s, NASA had to transport the second stage of the Saturn rocket at more than 1 million pounds, or 480,000 kilograms, from the production plant in California to the testing facility in Mississippi. And they did this with the use of Orion and Poseidon, NASA's two barges, going through the Panama Canal. But in case you've never seen a map, or confuse Utah with the 20 other square shapes that look just like it, Utah doesn't touch the ocean, and doesn't have any water shipping ports capable of shipping them by barge. This all meant the only realistic way to transport the boosters was by rail. So the boosters were manufactured in Utah, and had to be shipped to NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida by rail. But along the way, the boosters had to pass through the Moffett Tunnel in Colorado, a 6.2 mile long track barely wider than the 4 feet 8.5 inch tracks. The rocket sections had to fit through the tunnel, and so the engineers were forced to completely redesign the boosters. The final boosters designed for the space shuttle just barely fit through the tunnel, and were only half as wide as the boosters originally designed in Florida, but they made up for less total thrust by being twice as long. And so a decision by a Roman Empire 2,000 years in the past ended up redesigning one of the most advanced vehicles we've ever made. Sometimes your decisions can have surprisingly wide-reaching consequences. But NASA does a lot more than just design rockets. Check out this video to see 13 inventions NASA research gave the world. And don't forget to like and comment, since the algorithm seems to like that on us small channels. And remember, there is always more to learn.